My name is Tom Schneider. I'm the United States Attorney for the Eastern District of Wisconsin. And it is my pleasure today to announce the indictment of 17 members of the Outlaw Motorcycle Club for charges of racketeering, drug trafficking, and interstate transportation of explosives. The indictment by a federal grand jury in Milwaukee includes the presidents of four outlaw chapters in Wisconsin, La Crosse, Chicago Southside, and Gary, Indiana, as well as the indictment of the Chicago regional president. The indictment is a charge of RICO, and many of you are familiar or may not be familiar with the RICO charge. RICO stands for Racketeer Influenced and Corrupt Organizations. In order to prove or indict for an account of RICO, we have to first establish that there's an enterprise, and the indictment alleges that the Chicago region of the Outlaws is an enterprise. The next thing that the indictment alleges is that the defendants engaged use that enterprise to engage in a pattern of racketeering activity. Specifically, the indictment alleges 34 predicate or criminal acts in furtherance of the pattern of racketeering activity by the enterprise, that is, the enterprise of the Midwest or Chicago region of the Outlaws Motorcycle Club. The indictment charges that the Outlaws are more than a motorcycle club. They're a sophisticated and dangerous organized crime group that has repeatedly resorted to bombings, murder, to protect their ongoing criminal enterprises. Specifically, the indictment alleges 6 homicides. You can see from the chart over there 6 specific homicides that are alleged as predicate acts as part of the indictment, including the murder in 1992 of Donald Wagner in Racine County, the murder of Morris and Ruth Gauger in April of 1993 in McHenry County, Illinois, the murder in 1994 of Monty Mathias in Rockford, Illinois, the September 1994 murder of Michael Quayle in Lancaster, New York, and the murder in 1995 of Jack Castle in Chicago, Illinois. In addition to the allegation of the 6 homicides, there are a number of acts of additional violence, including bombings and attempted murders, that are alleged to be predicate offenses as part of this RICO indictment. These include the November 13, 1990 bombing of the Hell's Henchmen Motorcycle Clubhouse in Rockford, Illinois, the August 5, 1993 beating and bombing, robbery of 2 members of the Hell's Angels at 6th Tavern in Janesville, Wisconsin, the attempted bombing and murder of Eddie Murphy on October 30, 1993, and again on February 10, 1994, also the December 15, 1993 bombing and attempted murder of Patrick Matter in Minneapolis, Minnesota, the October 12, 1994 bombing and attempted murder of Roger Freebrantz, also in Rockford, Illinois, the November 7, 1994 bombing and attempted murder of Michael Coyne in Rockford, Illinois, the November 7, 1994 bombing and attempted murder of the at the Hell's Henchmen, Hell's Angels.
Did as we seized the property at 11 North Peninsula and 411 Main Street, which belonged to the Outlaw Motorcycle Gang. This was a result of an ongoing investigation started basically in 1994. 34 members were brought up on charges, and in 1995 all 34 members were convicted. The clubhouse and the business were used to further their criminal activity and their criminal enterprise.
Member. heavy security at the Outlaws trial today. About a dozen U.S. Marshals in the courtroom because of the gang's legendary violence. Prosecutors will try to convince jurors that gang members are racist, treat women like dirt, participate in kidnappings, bombings, murders, and drug trafficking. The gang's attorneys will argue the group is being targeted because of the unconventional way members look and live.
They're good guys. I mean, I haven't had any problems with them, and I don't think they didn't resist arrest. There was no problems with them. You know, they've been in jail all along, and there hasn't been any problems.
The Outlaws' Tampa and St. Petersburg clubhouses were shut down in September when federal agents announced the indictment of 18 gang members.
Like a mafia godfather wanted by the FBI, Harry Taco Bowman has been watched and chased by the government for years. Prosecutors say he was the leader of the notorious outlaw motorcycle gang.
They make their money through criminal activity, be it narcotics or prostitution, sometimes contract killing, sometimes extortion.
But Tuesday afternoon in federal court, Harry Bowman's reign came to an end. A jury convicted him of a long list of charges, including racketeering, drug possession, and murder.
It's incredible, the jury's verdict.
But why?
Based on the evidence presented and the law as the judge instructed.
During 4 weeks of testimony that included former gang members who turned against him, the government portrayed Bowman as a man who ordered killings and bombings, a man who eliminated his rivals through violence.
We're happy to see the jury, run through the exhibits, listen to the case carefully for 4.5 weeks, and we think they returned the appropriate and just verdict.
Inside the courtroom, emotions were high. Family members of Harry Taco Bowman burst out in tears as the verdict was read. The family whisked away in a black SUV, took the same route up Florida Avenue as Harry Bowman. However, the family is heading home. Bowman is heading to jail. In Tampa, Cecily Wilson, Fox 13 News.
Just check out the pool table. Don't look it up. Just look at it like you're looking at it. No, just look at the jets.
Check it out. Don't look at us.
Don't look at us. Just look like you're disgusted at it.
What happened last night?
Well, a bunch of the Gestapo type boys with their SWAT team gear barged in with a warrant for what I believe to be a single motorcycle from Wisconsin. I could be wrong on that. Held us all at bay with at gunpoint, kept us in the rain. And my wife here is pregnant, and they roughed her up. She told them that she was pregnant, and they roughed her up anyway and threw her on the ground. And
pretty. Went to hit me with a club.
And I think if they, we were knocked, and they could have come in and done their business a lot easier and better than the tactics they used.
What do you think about what happened last night, the day after?
It was bourgeois. I'm on camera. I can't say what I think in words, but it was pretty damn bourgeois. It was uncalled for, and I'm not too pleased with it at all.
You all right today?
Well, I'm all right, but I don't know how my kid is. You know, there might be something wrong with it when it comes out. I don't know.
Why do you think they did it?
I don't know. Is this election year?
No.
Well, it's a power play on their part, I imagine. I guess, why does anybody like that act like that? They've got the courts, they've got everything, and they abuse them to the maximum.
What are you going to do now?
Well, we're going to go back home, have some kind of thing they do to test women, have her checked out. If there is any damages, I'm going to get in touch with my attorneys and I'm going to sue the hell out of them.
The mile-long procession started at about 1:30 at the Outlaws' headquarters in Davie at 40th Avenue. The black hearse was followed by about 250 motorcycles in double file and a group of other trucks and cars carrying more gang members. This service was for Robert Cole Watts, who was known as Moonshine to his fellow outlaw members. Watts was killed in a traffic accident in Kentucky. In all, it was estimated that 400 of the gang members took part in the funeral procession. The group, with no police escort, drove undisturbed through Davie en route to the Westlawn Cemetery near Broward Community College. Even though it looked like a large turnout, police observers said that about half of the local gang members showed up. Half of the members attending the funeral were from out of town. At the cemetery, the outlaws removed Watts's casket from the hearse and carried it to the gravesite. The entire service took place while Broward County undercover officers took pictures of members from a distance. During the graveside services, as a memoriam, some outlaw members fired off weapons into the air. Police at the funeral said much of what the members did today was against the law, but if they took any action, it would prompt a war between the two factions. They also said the group would probably have a large party tonight at their clubhouse. Spiro Canton, Channel 4 News, Fort Lauderdale.
Stand over there and I'll walk by you.
Okay. How much do you need of this?
By the car, is that what you're saying?
Got a minute.
Well, what do you want?
In 3, 2, 1. Police officials in South Florida aren't optimistic about ending motorcycle gang violence. Investigators say that even if the outlaws are driven out of Broward County, another gang will simply spring up to take its place. In Fort Lauderdale, Jim Reynolds, Channel 10 Eyewitness News.
Where's that bike got the wires?
Back here.
Right here, back of the van.
You got enough cord, Bob.
Yeah, you got plenty of cord.
My friend here is,
okay, we got plenty of cord now? Oh.
Yeah, we got
plenty. Why don't you take us over that bike, yeah.
Pulling out those
wires again for me.
Try
cutting these.
Close it.
Really?
I got one real stuff in here.
step over here.
Okay. You get a wide shot first, see where we're going.
Come on in here on this side.
Okay.
Yeah, that's exactly what we said.
I said, even I couldn't think of something to do that bad to do.
See, same, but